Mr. Prabhu had argued that finance ministers must focus not just on the health of the economies, but also provide the financial support needed to protect the health of their people. Sri Prabhuji had earlier headed several important ministries in the Modi and Vajpayee governments, including railways, civil aviation, commerce and industry, and power. Originally a rank-holding chartered accountant, he went on to represent Rajapur parliamentary constituency for four successive terms and is currently a member of the Rajya Sabha. He is a member of several global organizations and strategic dialogues, including the United Nations Committee on Biodiversity. Sri Suresh Prabhuji is also adjunct professor at the National Institute of Advanced Studies and continues to motivate scientists and researchers with his unique lectures on environmental and social responsibilities and governance. I request Sri Suresh Prabhuji to deliver his talk.
So, good morning, friends. And I'm extremely pleased and honored at the same time to be at the NIAS, our top class institute. It's a national pride, and it's also a custodian of huge knowledge, not just for the scientific community, but probably for the humanity. Therefore, I'm very happy that I'm able to visit my institute without being there. And that is thanks to technology, that you could be here at the same time I can be far away. And therefore, I'm extremely pleased and honored that I'm there. I thank Dr. Naik for inviting me. And let me congratulate him for continuing the tradition of this institute to bring out the best available intellectual resource to the fore and bring it to for the benefit of the larger community. So today, I'm also honored by the fact that such two distinguished scholars, our Brain Trust of India, Dr. Dinesh Kumar Srivastava and Dr. V.S. Ramamurthy, come to it a little later, and both of them have been acknowledged globally for their intellectual capacity as well as for their commitment to the cause that they feel dearer to them. I know Dr. Ramamurthy very well. First, he was my colleague in the government. And then later on, I would say my boss in the NIAS, because I am the adjunct professor and he was the director. I heard and known about Dr. Srivastava a great deal. I don't think I got as much time as I would have liked to work with him. And I'm sure in future I'll get that opportunity. But both great scholars acknowledged for their knowledge all over have written this book, which is a contribution to a very important ongoing debate about the relationship between climate change and energy. I always maintain that they are the two sides of the same coin. You cannot deal with one without dealing with other. And therefore, he has established extremely well about the various connotations of climate change, essentially. And this obviously one book can attempt only at one particular aspect of it. Extremely close relationship with energy. And that too in context of sustainable future. Today, we are also celebrating Science Day, though it was actually yesterday, but obviously every day is a day. So we cannot have a Science Day on one day. It's like non-smoking day on one day and then smoke rest of the day, rest of the year. So Science Day is rightly celebrated today in continuation of our commitment to building a scientific society, a scientific temper. It is the right day to launch a book like this, particularly dealing with climate change. Because the debate on climate change is obviously many times emotional, obviously, because everybody is suffering. You can see in front of you your own house getting burnt. What you will feel then? You'll go to the root cause, you'll go to the first, you'll say, stop it. Stop my house from being burning. So emotions are bound to be there when you see the whole ecosystem collapsing. It's worse than the house, because one house is one person is affected, so he is emotional. Here everybody's life is threatened. Existential crisis. Obviously there has to be emotions attached to it. But sometimes if science doesn't support it, it may not be sustainable. The emotions may not last. People may not accept. So the debate on climate change also must have a scientific proof, a scientific evidence to support it. Therefore, today they're celebrating the Science Day and also releasing this book, which is based on science. In fact, globally, science has now put forward irrefutable evidence. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, is to be chaired by a very eminent person, Dr. Pachauri. And he did a great job. Unfortunately, he's not there. But IPCC, consisting of best of scientists from the world, both from developing countries, from all parts of the world, from all disciplines, they come out with evidence that climate change is human induced. So these proponents of action to be taken on climate change and opponents who say there's no need to take action, and that included, the opponents included some top leaders of one of the more developed countries of the world, with all scientific top institutions available in that country. With the previous administration agreed that we must be taking action on this climate change, the next admission said, no, it's not necessary. I will walk out of it. But science has proved beyond doubt that climate change is a reality, is a certainty. And that is the issue of debate, actually. Climate change may be there. That's what the opponents of climate change action will tell you. But why should we act? Because this is nature's creation. Why should we do anything? Climate always has been changing, which is true. But this particular climate change that we are experiencing today, or we are suffering from, not just experiencing, we are victims of it, is caused by human beings. It is proved beyond doubt. In fact, the science has proved it, but I'll give one more example. And that happened probably not by design, but by accident. Last year, a good part of last year, you can say the three quarters of last year, beginning from April, most of the world at various stages had a lockdowns. When the lockdown happened, and this happened, the lockdowns happened in different places at different times, in different dimensions and different timings. But one thing happened in each of those countries, each of the geographies where the lockdown happened. Suddenly the air quality improved. Suddenly the flora and fauna came back. Some places we saw the wildlife moving on the road. What happened during the lockdown? The humans retreated and nature came back. We need any more evidence? IPCC has proved it. And Dr. Srivastava, Dr. Ramurthy have argued very effectively. But this is something which we experienced ourselves as late as few weeks ago, few months ago. That human action, if it is not there, then biodiversity comes back. The nature, the air becomes clean. So now, my friends who oppose it, and they oppose it not necessarily because they believe in opposing it, but they have vested interest in opposing it. My grandmother used to tell me, it is easy for a person who is sleeping, you can wake him up. But who pretends to be sleeping, you can never wake him up. So those who are opposing the reality of climate change have some best interest. Otherwise, they should accept the science or come out with a better science. And therefore, climate change is no longer an academic issue anymore for anybody in the world, except those who have vested interest. Others are suffering from it. And as just now, the very good presentation that we saw on the screen, made by Dr. Srivastava, the typhoons, the droughts, the flooding, the natural disasters. And these are something which are very visible. And you feel them very clearly, prominently. But what about inhaling the bad air? What about the public health implications of climate change, which may be slow poisoning, so you don't see it clearly? What about the loss of biodiversity, which has already happened in a significant way, the terrestrial biodiversity? And now we are not satisfied with it, so we are going after marine biodiversity. Just imagine, that's the only thing that probably human beings will understand it better. Because there is no species on the planet. Biodiversity means so many species of different kinds. No species on this planet is as selfish, as self-centered as human beings. They're not worried about anybody else. Only interest that drives them is self-interest. But if we remind them that if the biodiversity disappears, we are going to disappear tomorrow. I used to tell, as when I was environment and forest minister, people used to ask me, why are you worried about tigers? Let's kill them. And there were very few left at that time anyway. So killing them was easy because the rest of them were killed by our brave Maharajas earlier. And our unfortunate, the merchants of death who could make money from tiger skin, tiger teeth, and many other parts of the tiger, they would kill them. So not many were left anyway. So I used to remind my friends that if tiger, who is at apex of the food chain, and therefore he guarantees that the chain below him is surviving because he's there, that means he's guaranteeing us that. If tiger goes today, human beings will disappear tomorrow. So the loss of biodiversity as a result of climate change, as a result of human action, is threatening the entire ecosystem of the world, of the planet. And therefore, climate change is a real, real problem that we must address, which is going to have different dimensions. Of course, the book deals with energy and its relationship with climate change. But there is very different aspects of it. Water, fisheries, agriculture, because if the sea level rises, fisheries and tourism, all of that will be greatly affected. The glaciers, if they disappear, and they are actually happening today, it's not just a fantasy world that we should live in and just close our eyes to reality. It's all happening around us in different parts of the world. So when people raise their voice against burning of forest in Amazon, it is not, it's just to criticize one country and the others are sitting in faraway place and therefore they're criticizing. Each one of us will be affected even by that faraway forest fire, because ecosystem is interconnected. So glaciers melting will affect the oceans. Oceans are also somewhere or the other have connection with each other. And that's what I was saying, the marine biodiversity. So my friends, I thank once again our two distinguished scholars, two scientific leaders, great scientists, great academicians, for bringing out this very interesting book on energy options for sustainable future. It's nobody's argument. And even these great two scholars have argued that we need energy. In fact, the book also talks about the linkage of energy with human development index. If you go by Africa or India, our per capita consumption of electricity is so low. Whereas per capita consumption of electricity is very high in developed countries. Now sometimes, our great friends in FMCG business, fast moving consumer good business, they argue that India has to progress a lot more. Why? Because the per capita consumption of Coca-Cola in India is very low. In US, it may be several liters. In India, it's hardly anything. So India is very least developed country. So one way for India to develop is start taking more Coke, drink more Coke. So we'll be obese. So there'll be good business, of course, economic benefit, because there'll be more healthcare spending. More doctors will benefit, so economic benefit, that's a good argument. So one way of looking at is energy consumption per capita in India. One should not say that we should go up to the level of what US or some other developed countries are consuming. And that's another point that the book makes, is about lifestyles. The energy consumption is because of lifestyle that you live in. When I was a power minister of India, I used to go to Europe and I used to see why they keep these lights on so many for throughout the night. Can they not switch it off? Because in India, there was no light, no electricity. I made that law, Electricity Act, which transformed it from deficit electricity to now surplus. But surplus again is a debatable issue. I'm not getting into that today. But lifestyle change, so we don't have to go to that level. But point I'm saying is that nobody can say that there should not be energy. Energy has to be there. Right manner, what is necessary. As the authors have said, from hunter-gatherers to this place, we have traveled a long distance. And because of that, some inevitable lifestyle change. We cannot even say that we should go back to that time of hunter-gatherers as we were once upon a time, as humanity, not Indians. Or for that matter, there's a human. There's no country at that time when the first human being was born. But energy has to be there, but what energy? That's an issue. Whether we should use the energy which has caused the climate change to begin with. It happened after Industrial Revolution. It coincided with extensive use of fossil fuels. And that's how the climate change is. Again, very unmistakable linkage between the two. Now, let's come to the extremely well-written, well-thought-of book. And as I just saw on the screen, as Dr. Srivastava mentioned, in short, so people read it. Do I say that that's not the only reason I read it? Because it is written in short. But I read it because it's so brilliant. And some of the energy options, one is fossil fuel. I personally feel, I'm also incidentally a founding chairman of a think tank called Council for Energy, Environment and Water, CEW. In fact, the reason why I called it in that way was the linkage between energy, environment and water, which was always missing. and I was worried about it. In fact, one of the energy options, as been mentioned in the book, is water. Whether you want hydroelectricity, it's the water is the source of that. In fact, water is necessary in many areas, including we don't realize it. Even in solar, the panels needs cleaning and needs a lot of water. Or even in solar thermal, which also has been mentioned as one of the options. So when I was dealing with this, as the chairman of this, founding chairman of this think tank, which are now run extremely well by Dr. Arunabha Ghosh, and is doing very well. But I, at that time, also was looking at the options should be seen from the perspective, and also must understand its implication on so many other sectors. We can have one option and in the process can create another problem. So we must have an option which does not create any more problem while solving one problem. That's the energy problem we solve, but we might create another problem related to environment or other sectors. So we must have proper holistic thinking on it, which the book has done extremely well. So one, fossil fuel, I was saying, why I was mentioning this was, fossil fuel, today is a transition that will happen from fossil fuel to non-fossil fuel economy. While it is there, whether it's coal, whether it's gas, all oil, we need to have clean technologies in that also. So I think we should not just throw the baby with the hot water. We should try to think about how to clean technologies can address it. So we have to work on that. But that cannot be the reason that we should get stuck to it. We should use it for transition, for some time, not for all times to come. The clean coal technologies. Many of these ideas that we have worked on, even supercritical, and I was just jokingly, I should say that time, you can use super or super or super, but a situation is critical. You can use supercritical technologies to bring down the emissions, but situation of world is very critical, so we must keep that in mind. And therefore, the criticality of situation, not a supercritical technologies, demands that we should move towards non-fossil fuel options. And that includes many options, as the book itself has so intelligently brought out. Sun is a source of all energy, actually. So solar, whether it's photovoltaic or solar thermal, both are very good options and very well put in the book. In fact, in India, or for that matter, all over the world, we are using more of solar photovoltaic because the prices are coming down, the panel prices are coming down. Efficiency hopefully should improve over a period of time. But solar thermal is not as effectively and as widely used as it should be. Particularly when we have such deserts in India, as well as the nature itself has created desert. So it was a design by nature that even desert can come to rescue our people. We always see desert means desert has other abilities. I remember I had gone to Jordan and I was talking to a person in the desert, Badi, and asking him, would you like to, because this is such a desert, you like to leave this place? He said, no, I want to live in desert and I want my child to live in desert, though I would like him to educate it outside, because desert gives you messages which are best that we can understand. So desert is also source of energy, solar thermal. And therefore, I feel that we should try to work on all these issues effectively. Wind, I used to be on another think tank, and we done pro bono research for the country. There is a potential for wind onshore could be as high as 200,000-300,000 megawatts. Of wind offshore can be even more. So is the case of tidal, which the book argues. Because we have 7,600 kilometers of coastline. And tides will actually generate energy. We have possibility of biomass. My only issue in biomass is, because I was also Minister of Chemicals and Fertilizers, that we feel biomass is agriculture waste, which is actually, I don't agree. The biomass, the falling leaves from the tree or others, also serve some ecological purpose. If the ones they get into the soil, they also add value to it by nutrients. But we must therefore do holistic study again on this, that how much of biomass can be used for fuel or for energy, and how much should be allowed to go back into the soil. Maybe think about it, but it's a very good option that is available to us. Nuclear. I think particularly in context of climate change, nuclear power is the best option. Not I will just say best, one of the very good options. Why? Because it does not emit any greenhouse gases. In fact, this is what I had argued in the parliament when the then government, though I was in opposition, had said, and we were opposed to that nuclear deal at that time politically, but I had said that one thing about this nuclear deal which helped India is, of course, that didn't really materialize into the kind of, hopefully we wanted to generate nuclear energy, but it would help to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Because if you can move from coal, gas and fossil fuels to nuclear, it actually helps in reducing greenhouse gas emissions. And there's a book again talks about, but other issues related to that. That's what I was saying, think holistically. Whether it's nuclear waste or nuclear safety, health issues related to that, the radiation, others, all these have been properly dealt with in the book. But point I'm saying is, that is option. In fact, I used to talk about when the CDM, Clean Development Mechanism, was one of the instrument that was talked, market-based instrument that was thought about under the Kyoto Protocol. I used to say that you must allow the nuclear power. That time my colleague, the French minister, used to oppose it. So I said, you know, I'm surprised you oppose it because France has highest nuclear energy in Europe at least, and one of the top in the world also. But nuclear is absolutely an option and we should work on it. I'm just talking about, and the book talks about it, shale gas, shale oil, fracking. My point is, and there's a very interesting point in fact that Gawar used to be used from India. I didn't know it actually. And now Brazil, they're importing from Brazil. In fact, US suddenly has become from importer to exporter of oil and gas. Why? Because of shale gas and fracking technologies, which of course the present administration in US has issues with that because the relationship with climate change. And particularly where do you fracking is important. Fracking itself may not be a problem, but where are you doing in Alaska or you are doing somewhere else, which are so fragile ecosystem, it's an issue. But my point on fracking is the water. Fracking uses huge quantities of water. And that's how, in fact, it opens up the potential gas or oil inside the rocks. Do we have so much of water? Maybe some countries have, but when you're looking at global issues, we should also look at it as very closely. At one point, I don't know whether I could have missed out in this book, probably, I don't know, is energy efficiency issue. Again, I remember it because I am the farmer. I actually had piloted the bill energy efficiency law in the parliament. And in that, I created the first Bureau of Energy Efficiency administratively. Dr. Shashi Shekhar, then I had appointed him as the first director of Bureau of Energy Efficiency. I'm talking about 2001 or so. So energy efficiency is another, not energy option is right. Actually, the book talks about source of energy. I'm talking about once you apply energy, once you generate it, you must also have energy efficiency, because otherwise you can generate as much, and that was the question I was saying, that per capita consumption. So we want to go by per capita consumption of Coke, per capita consumption of Pepsi. So therefore we must, and even I forgot, per capita consumption of donuts, per capita consumption of what valuable in McDonald's. I think that is very low in India. So India is backward, and so is Africa, and so are the countries. They must increase their consumption. So that could not be the argument. Same way, generating electricity for the sake of doing it as a competition to other countries cannot be necessary. You must use what is necessary, have best possible efficiency norms, and that's why I'm saying once you have efficiency, you don't have to generate that much electricity. So that again, if not an option, should be an issue that you must consider. I think I once again congratulate them. You know, I am supposed to be doing my PhD, doctoral studies on climate change and energy. But I could never even think of doing as good, it is impossible that knowing these two scholars, even one page as good as this I could have written. And therefore, I'm doing my PhD in Freie University, Berlin. But I'm doing it for a long time. It's like India's earlier 5-year plans. They're good plans, but outcome was always question. So intention is not the only way you can create situations or things. But I really congratulate them. I don't know, I must have taken more time. That's why I'm stopping. Otherwise, this is the topic on which I would love to talk, not just talk, but act. That's why I created this think tanks. I'm on several bodies related to climate change globally. I participate in almost all important deliberations on climate change. Recently, there was a very interesting high-level in-camera meeting on Friends of Paris. When Paris was happening, just before that, there was a very important meeting that took place. I'd said Paris is the capital of fashion. When the Paris Accord was about to take place, not whether we didn't know the accord, but Paris round of COP, I'd said, let Paris be the new capital of mission, passion. Let's accomplish something. So that's why there was a conference and I participated recently into that as Friends of Paris. But I'm just saying, while I once again thank my great institution, NIAS, I congratulate the great scientist authors for doing this great job and adding to value to this whole debate on climate change. And not, I think, as I said, no more debate, action is necessary. No more talk, only now walk the talk. Don't promise money which the developed countries, the so-called annex one countries, are supposed to put in. And I said they promised billions, but not even 1 million was seen, because I used to jokingly tell them that I know it takes long time to count billions. So that's why you must be still counting. Hopefully one day it will come on the table. But my congratulations once again. Thank you for inviting me. Without being qualified to be participating in this program with such great scholars, such great intellectuals who are actually rightfully in the room or participating in this debate. I probably on a periphery, because you know, when top cricketers, top sports person play, you also need a spectator, right? So spectator doesn't know anything about a game, but he still participates. So I'm one of the spectators in this galaxy of intellectuals. So thank you very much for inviting me. Congratulations to all of them. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Vishwesh Prabhuji, for your important and inspiring talk. You all resonate with the ideas and examples.